Hi, and welcome to this session, Business Analysis with Transact SQL. Thank you for coming to this conference and thank you for attending this session. My name is Dejan Sarka. I am pretty long time in this area. I am working for 35 years in IT and more than 20 years out of this with SQL Server and more than 30 years with statistics, data mining, machine learning, data science. I authored or co-authored 19 books so far and even more courses and of course hundreds of different presentations in different events. I focus in data science, but also data modeling and data quality. This session is based on my latest 19th book, Advanced Analytics with Transact SQL. Of course, it doesn't cover the whole book, but it covers parts of the book. I will talk about the following topics. Relational division, and then I will switch to ABC analysis, talk about time-oriented data and survival analysis, market basket analysis, then I will define look-alike model and finish this presentation with naive Bayes algorithm or Bayesian inference implemented with Transact SQL. Before I even start with the relational division, you might ask yourself, why do I want to make these solutions in Transact SQL when we have now R, Python, and Azure Machine Learning and many, many other tools? Well, if you are working with huge amounts of data, then Transact SQL might be still the programming language of your choice. It is optimized to work with huge data sets. Of course, it is not optimized for analysis in loops. This is where row-oriented, not set-oriented languages or procedural languages come into the game. For example, you all heard about R and Python. They are both extremely powerful in the area of data science. However, if you can find algorithms that do not need too many loops over your data, then the Transact SQL might be the good choice. Definitely, it is set-oriented, it can easily consume huge sets of data, but as I said, you cannot make loops. And the point here is to find these algorithms that can be resolved without many loops, with single or maybe two passes through data. This way, then you can really handle huge, huge data sets, process them in parallel, much more in parallel than with R and with Python, and reach magnitudes better performance than with this row oriented languages. Of course, without loops, there is a limited choice of algorithms you can implement. Anyway, enough of this introduction. I will just start with the relational division. Let me start with checking the data. I will use the AdventureWorks ZW 2017 demo database. And I will get my data from the DBOFACT Internet Sales and DBOFACT Reseller Sales tables. And let me check distribution of orders by the year of order date. So I am grouping by year of order date and counting number of orders, also returning minimal and maximal order date. Let me execute this. What I see is I have most of the orders in years 2011, 12, and 13, and only few orders in the years 2010 and 2014. I will use this data later for survival analysis. However, as I can see, these orders in years 2010 and 2014 are more like exceptions. So I will just create two views where I will use all of the data except this 2 years. So first view for internet sales where year order date is between 2011 and 2013, and then also view for reseller sales. Let me check the data again, unioning both reseller and internet sales, and now I have 3 years, only 2011, 2012, and 2013. Now when the data is prepared, let me switch to slides and start with my first analysis. I will start with what is theoretically called relational division. Relational division is one of the original relational operators defined by Mr. Kot. Let's first see the definition, and then let's try to explain this definition and then see the example. Formal definition: a divisor relation partitions a dividend relation to produce a quotient relation, like any division. Dividend and divisor must be in many-to-many relationship. The quotient is made up of those values of one attribute from the dividend relation, for which the second column of the intermediate relation contains all of the values from the divisor relation. This is kind of hard to understand. Let's see this graphically. So we have relation ABC, which is a dividend, and then we have relation XZ, which is a divisor. And then we have intermediate relations. So relations ABC and XZ are in many-to-many relationship. And as we see, we have combinations AX, AY, AZ, BX, BY. And the quotient is made of those values of attribute from the dividend relation, for which the second column in the intermediate relation contains all of the values from the divisor relation. So we have combinations AX, AY, AZ. Divisor is XZ. So value A is related to all of the values from the divisor. And value B is related to X, is related to Y, but not to Z. So the result, the quotient, is the relation with the single element A. So what does it mean in real life? This looks extremely, extremely theoretical. So in real life, let me switch to demos. So in real life, what I'm searching is customers that have purchased all of the distinct products, or in this case, I will start with product categories. So I'm searching for the best customers. And one criteria might be how many distinct or different products have these customers purchased from me. The more distinct products a customer purchased, the better the customer is. So first, I will do this in the product category level first. So I will use FACT Internet Sales joined to DIM product and then product subcategory and product category. Filter out components. Components are not selling. Grouping by customer key and then counting distinct English product category names or distinct product categories, ordering by discount, the standing, and then customer ID. So we have, okay, this is minimal category accessories. So we have customer 11,000 has purchased products from three different categories. And so on. And then there are some customers like 13,852 that has purchased products only from single category, in this case bikes. Now this is not relational division yet. Now let's find customers who purchased products from all categories. Here we have count of distinct categories, and I will just compare this count to count star from DIM product category and search for those that have count distinct purchased categories equals to count star from DIM product category, where of course category is not components. So we have customers that have purchased products from all categories. I have altogether 2022 rows. These are my customers that have purchased products from all categories, my 2000 customers. This might be an interesting analysis, and of course you can now expand this analysis limited by the time, for example. So let's see which customers have purchased products from all distinct categories in the year 2012. Of course, I will get less customers. I get only 14 customers that already purchased products from all different categories in the year 2012. Okay, this is one way how you can analyze your sales. In this case, relational division, although well-defined theoretically operator, might also have some interesting implementations in real life. So give me customers that purchased every single product or every single product category we are selling. Next analysis that is very, very frequently performed is ABC analysis. Let's start again with the formal definition. ABC analysis is a categorization method in which an entity set of an interest, for example, customers, products, is divided in three categories named A, B, and C in descending value. A has the highest value in terms of our business, for example, profit or total sales. B is lower than A and C has the lowest value. Typical breakdown is that A items, 20% of those A items contribute to 70-80% of the profit. B items is usually the next 30% of items that contribute approximately 15-25% of the profit. And C items is the rest of 50% items that usually contribute to 5% of the total profit only. Maybe you heard for Pareto principle, very well known principle 80-20. 80% of overall value comes from 20% of items. This is a specific example of ABC analysis where we split data into two subclasses, only A and the rest, B and C, together. So let's start analyzing our customers. Let's go back to demos. So how do we define these groups A, B, and C? Maybe we can check number of order lines. Okay, this is one option, usually not the best, but we will at least get the most frequent customers. So we will count absolute frequency by customer key of the internet sales, where I have data on the order line level. And then I will just calculate the running totals. Up to here is so many order lines. So let's calculate this with window aggregate functions. And what I see is customer 11,300 has absolute frequency 67, order lines, which is a little bit more than 0.11% of all order lines. And the next customer has 65 order lines, cumulative frequency is 132 up to here, and the percentage is 0.11127. And I also see a brief histogram with these stars. And I have cumulative percentage, so first two customers have 0.2% of all order lines. Let's see where I get 10%. And I see that I get 10% of all order lines pretty late in this data. I need nearly 500 customers to get 10% of order lines. Of course, counting order lines is usually not the best way to analyze your customers. Might tell you something. But let's check top product models. Product models ranked by sales amount. And this time I will union the data from internet and reseller sales. Internet sales, I have customers data. For reseller sales, I do not have customers data. It goes sales through reseller channel, but of course in both cases I have products. And here we have the union of all data, and then I will again summarize the sales, and then I will calculate running totals and order by sales descending. So I will have top product models in the beginning or at the top of the result set. So my top product is Mountain 200 bike, which has running percentage 14.5. So first product contributed nearly 15% to overall sales. First two, nearly 27. Let's check first 10, and we are already close to 80%. We have altogether 107 product models. So in this case, group A, which contributes to 80% of sales, consists of 11 products only. So group A has only 10% of all data in this case. And of course, now this ABC analysis has much, much more sense. And let's see, where do I get to 95% of sales? So 23 products at 20%, little bit more, 25%. I came to 95% of the total sales. Of course, this is total sales. Now I could also calculate profit. I could also calculate order quantity. This is up to you how you define what you will analyze, what value will define these three groups. Okay, let's continue with the next topic, survival analysis. This might be a very interesting topic for business people. With survival analysis, we want to estimate the lifespan of a particular population. It is also sometimes called time-to-event analysis. Estimate the time for an individual or group to start or to experience an event. Very similar is mean time between failure analysis. Lifespan of a customer, for example, or lifespan of a machine can be calculated over time. We have two options. Maybe we have subscription model where a customer cannot enter and exit at any time in the study. So a customer starts subscription and then a customer officially ends the subscription. So we have strict start and exit or end time. However, with a regular, let's say, retail market, retail shops, a subject, a customer can enter and exit at any time in the study. And not every case experiences the event of interest in a specific time frame, churn, error, like mean time between failure. We must have a variable that indicates the event of interest. Survival function defines the probability that the event of interest has not occurred at the time t. So, churn, a customer is leaving us. The probability of survival after time t can be calculated. The hazard function, which is also called the intensity function, is the probability that the case will experience an event of interest within a small time interval when the subject has survived until the beginning of the interval. So we have hazard of, let's say, 5% that a customer will leave us after a year and a half. The risk of the event at time t is the number of cases with the event in the interval beginning at time t divided by the product of the number of cases surviving at time t and interval width. So let's start calculating these terms. First, let's define some cutoff date. Let's try to check which customers were not active in the last years. In the last year, remember I have 3 years of data, 2011, 12 and 13. And in the VInternet sales, I have also customers. So I will use DBO VInternet sales only. And I will calculate, I will group by customer key, and then I will calculate maximal last order date and date diff between max order date and 1 year before max order date. Let me execute this subquery. So I am defining the 1st of January 2013 as cutoff date, and I'm checking which customers were not active in the last year with the number of days from the last purchase. So I am grouping this data by customer key, filtering after aggregation, having max order date greater than the cutoff date. Remember, 1st of January 2013, and then calculating the number of days with this from the last purchase. Let me execute this query, and I see Sydney Rogers, last order date was 2nd of January 2011, apparently Sydney was not active in the last year, and it is 730 days from the last purchase of this customer. Of course, I can define arbitrary cutoff date. For example, I will say having max order date lower than 1st of March 2013. So I want to find all customers that made the purchase before 28th of February 2013, but no purchase later. And I can also calculate the difference in days between minimum order date and maximum order date as tenure days for each customer, how many days this customer was loyal to our company. Here we have the results. So Ruben Torrens' first purchase was first 7th of January 2011. Last purchase 23rd of February 2013. Altogether, this customer was loyal 778 days. However, apparently, I don't have any purchase after the cutoff date, which was 1st of March 2013. And I can check this for every single customer. And I ordered the data by tenure days descending. So some customers, like Warren Chen, made a single purchase on the 22nd of February 2013, then maybe another one on 23rd of February 2013, and that was it. So this customer was loyal for a single day. We have all together 414 customers that have more than one order and no purchase after my cutoff date, 28th of February 2013. I define those as these are the customers that have succumbed to risk. They are not my customers anymore. I will just store these customers in a table, and I will also add a fictitious reason why this customer has left me. I will just make 1/3 of this customer involuntary and 2/3 voluntary end of tenure. So involuntary would mean probably this customer didn't pay in time, so I simply dropped the customer by myself. So let me create a new table, customer survival, where I will store this data using arbitrary cutoff date, 1st of March 2013, storing customer ID, customer name, start date and stop date, tenure days, and stop reason, involuntary or voluntary. So I'm storing these 414 customers in this table. Okay. Now I will add active customers. New customers are not included here because I'm analyzing only those who had the first purchase before the cutoff date. New customers are not interesting for survival analysis after a cutoff date. So I am adding active customers where we have null as stop date, null as stop reason, and I'm calculating tenure days from the minimal order date for a customer, a difference in days between minimal order date for a customer and my arbitrary cutoff date. So I'm adding these active customers in my table for survival analysis. I'm adding 6,442 rows. Let me add primary key and check some data ordered by new ID, so I get kind of random ordering. So I have Christina Beck started, her first purchase was 6th of April 2012, and until cutoff date, she was loyal for 328 days. Stop date is still null. At the cutoff date, stop date didn't happen yet, and stop reason is, of course, also unknown. But we have some people like Johnny Chavez, who left me on 5th of February 2013 voluntarily. Apparently, this customer simply didn't appear later. And we have Caitlin Morris. I canceled this customer after 193 days on 10th of January 2013, and stop reason involuntary is very general. Apparently, I didn't like this customer. So let's check minimal and maximal start and stop dates. So I have Minimal start date, of course, 1st of January 2011. Maximal stop date, 28th of February 2013. And minimal stop date, 28th of December 2012. And max start date on the same date as the arbitrary cutoff date. Apparently, I have a customer who made a purchase on 28th of February 2013. So let's do the survival analysis. So we'll filter the customers that have the first purchase in the last year before the cutoff date. And then we'll calculate the number of those customers and then the number of those customers that succumbed to risk already in the first year and the number of customers that succumbed to risk after 1 year and the number and the percentage of the customers that are still active after 2 years. So I will have 365 days of tenure cutoff and calculate population at risk and then calculate how many of those customers succumbed to risk in the first year and then in after first year and are still active after 2 years and then calculate also percentage of customers that survived after 1 year. And of course, start date is 1 year before the cutoff date. So let's calculate this data. What we see in the results, we were checking how many customers are leaving me in 1 year, after 1 year, and are still active. So only 9 customers have really left me in the first year. The total population at risk is 2,728 customers. So it means these are customers that have the first purchase in the last year before the cutoff date. Okay? And 9 of those left me in the first year, 232 after 1 year, and I still have more than 91% active customers. Let's calculate the hazard for every single tenure length in days. Now, when I have this table, customer survival, I can group by tenure days and count all population and risk, and then calculate the number of customers that succumbed to risk at any specific tenure days. So, 0 days, population at risk 27, so I have a single purchase, nobody succumbed to risk. Okay, I could also define that all of them succumb if there was not another purchase. 1 day, we have 41 customers that had purchases in 2 consecutive days, and one of them is not a customer anymore. And then we have 10 days, we have 28 customers at population at risk, nobody succumbed at 10 days. And so on. 47 days, I have 3 customers, 15 days, sorry, I have 3 out of 47 customers that succumbed at 15 days. Now, of course, I can group this data and calculate probabilities for up to 365 days. Let's calculate this. Of course, I could then calculate probability up to whatever number of days I wanted. So up to 365 days, I have population at risk 6,856. And 183 succumbed to risk. This is 2.67%. Let's calculate cumulative hazard and survival. Of course, I will first calculate aggregates over every single tenure days, and then I will use running totals to summarize population at risk at specific tenure days, those that succumbed at tenure days, and running total of those that succumbed to risk up to specific tenure days, and then also calculate the percentage of those, right? And then also how many survived up to tenure days. Let's calculate this one. Becomes a little bit more complex analysis. So tenure days, population at risk 27, total population 6,856, nobody succumbed at tenure up to tenure, percentage 0, survived 100% up to tenure. Let's check some other tenures, maybe like first one, 30 days. At exactly 30 days, we had 37 customers that were loyal exactly for 30 days. None of them succumbed to risk at 30 days, but up to 30 days, 16 succumbed to risk from the total population 6,856. So up to tenure 30 days, we have 0.23% of customers that left me, and 99.76% of customers that have survived up to tenure. Let's check, for example, 180 days, 6 months approximately. So we have 96 customers that succumbed to risk up to this tenure, which is 1.4%, and 98.6% are still loyal after 6 months. Now, of course, I can check this for every single tenure days I have available. Now I can also analyze the customers that succumb to risk. For example, I have now this stop reason. So I can group by stop reason. Remember, this was arbitrarily selected. I have approximately 2/3 of customers that that voluntarily left me and 1/3 involuntarily. And I can check what is percentage of profit of those who voluntarily left me and involuntarily. Apparently, it's slightly lower for those that involuntarily left me. Of course, they were not too good customers. But remember, I just made up this data, but might be interesting analysis in some real life scenario. Of course, I can now break down this by any variable I want. So for example, I will check profit in percentage for those where stop reason is not null, grouped by number of cars owned and region, and check. So for example, those who have left me from Europe and have 3 cars, we have 2 orders, 5 order details, percentage of profit was 42, quite high. On the other hand, those without cars from Pacific region, I have 52 orders, 102 order details, and average profit in percentage is 38% only. Of course, I can also do additional analysis, for example, by region and number of cars owned, pivoted, so I can use pivot operator and check sum of sales amount over regions and number of cars owned for those where stop reason is not null. And I can see I have very high sales amount for those in Pacific with 1 car, and very low null sales amount for those from Europe with four cars. Apparently, those are still with me. The next topic I want to discuss is market basket analysis. In this analysis, you try to find out which items are typically sold together. This way, you can organize products on shelves or do the recommendations when you have a web shop. Market basket analysis is done with the association rules algorithm. This algorithm considers each attribute value pair, such as product, bicycle, as an item. An item set is a combination of items in a single transaction. The algorithm scans through the dataset, trying to find item sets that tend to appear together in many transactions. Now we can calculate multiple terms. Let's start with the support. Support is the number of rows with the item set compared to the total number of rows or transactions. So we have here an example. Transaction 1 is frozen pizza, cola, milk. Transaction 2, milk, potato chips. Transaction 3, cola, frozen pizza. Transaction 4, milk, pretzels. And transaction 5, cola, pretzels. The support for the rule: if customers purchase cola, then they will purchase frozen pizza, is 2 out of 5 transactions, which means the support is 0.4. There are totally 5 rows, and 2 of them include both cola and frozen pizza. Of course, item set with higher support might be more important than item set with a very low support. But let's check the rule: if customers purchase cola, then they will purchase frozen pizza again. Can we reverse the rule and say if customers purchase frozen pizza, then they will purchase cola as well? Of course, we could say this way as well. However, the support would still be the same, 0.4. But which rule is better? We can define the next term, confidence. Confidence is the support for the combination divided by the support for the condition. So we have combination potato chips plus milk, which is in one of the 5 transactions. So support is 0.2. However, if I say if milk then potato chips, then support for milk is 0.6, because milk appears in the first, second and fourth transaction. Therefore, the confidence of the rule: if customers purchase milk, they will purchase potato chips, is 33%, or 0.33. 20% or 0.2 is the support for the combination, and 0.6 is the support for the condition. However, if we turn around the rule, if customers purchase potato chips, then they will purchase milk, the confidence for this rule is 100%, because we have support for the combination 0.2 and support for the condition potato chips, which is also 0.2. Potato chips appears only in the second transaction. Therefore, I could say that confidence, if customers purchase milk, they will purchase potato chips, is much higher. So this rule might be more important. I have a lot of demos for association rules, so I will just switch to demos and then return back to slides. We have 2 views: we ASOCSIC line items and we ASOCSIC orders in the AdventureWorks DW 2017 demo database. I will just create permanent tables because of performance. And let's do the same thing from orders, and let's add the cluster at primary key. Let's check few rows. So we have orders, and here we have some associated attributes. So we have order number, customer key, and also region and income group. This might help later in further analysis. And here are line items. So order number SO613123 has three products, line numbers 1 to 3, and here we have these models, road 350W, cycling cap, sport 100. The next order has only a single item, hitch rack for bike, and the next one has 5 items. So I can start checking frequency of item sets with a single model. So I'm just grouping by model and counting the rows with this model. So the most popular item is Sport 100, then water bottle, then patch kit, and so on. Before searching for those models that are sold together, I can also do the opposite search for models that have been purchased only in a single order alone. Customers bought the model and never anything else. So I'm counting distinct order numbers and models, and I am grouping by customer key and then searching for those models that appear in a single order only and the customer never purchased anything else. So these are the models that do not go well together with other models. Now, before I continue with this analysis, I must make a comment. Analyzing association rules can be a pretty tedious task, because you can get thousands and thousands of rules and it's practically impossible to check all of them. So you order these rules based on different criteria and try to find those that are really important. Negative rules might be also important. However, water bottle is a pretty frequent item. So it might also happen that it's not so negative as it looks from this first analysis. You really have to look at these associations from multiple different sides, from multiple perspectives. So we can also check which model is purchased only once in a single order and then do this pivoting by a region. Okay. So we can see which models are less popular in or go worse together with other models in specific regions. So for example, water bottle is usually purchased alone, especially in North America. We can also do pivoting by income group with orders. I have some additional interesting attributes for further analysis. And what we have here is medium income, high income, moderate income, low income. And I can see that water bottle is typically purchased alone by the people with high income. So I already learned a couple of things. Now let me search for support or frequency of item sets with two models. I can do this in different ways. I can start by joining line items to line items. Join is done on order number, and the model from the left is greater or different than model from the right. And then I can count star to find the support and order by support descending. And I can see that water bottle goes very well with mountain bottle cage and road bottle cage. We have really high support. Sport 100 goes very well with mountain tire tube. and so on. Instead of using join, I can use apply, cross apply from line items from the left, cross apply subquery on the right, again selecting model from the line items based on order number from the left equals to the order number from the right, and model from the left is greater than model from the right. So I get, of course, the same results with the apply operator. So it's up to you which path you want to take. Again, mountain bottle, cage, water bottle has very high support. Of course, water bottle is a very popular model. It was many times purchased alone, but also many times it is purchased with other products. I like more the syntax with apply because it seems a little bit more readable, especially when you want to search for a frequency of item sets with 3, 4 or even more models. So I can find all pairs and then I apply again on this result, I apply again a subquery from line items, again joining on the same order number and searching for model that is not available in the pair yet. So I find the most popular item sets with 3 models. So the most popular item set with 3 models is mountain bottle, cage, mountain 200 bike and water bottle. Support is 343. Of course, now I could add the 4th model and so on. But not, as I mentioned, I don't want to search for the support only. I want to express this item set as rules. So first, I will find all possible pairs. Please note that now this apply condition, where condition has changed a bit. I'm still searching for models that appear in the same order. However, now I don't have model from the left is greater than model from the right. I have model from the left is different from the model from the right. So I will get 2 rows for each pair. And now I can count support for these 2 models and express the rules with model 1, then model 2. So let's check the rules. So I have water bottle, then mountain bottle, cage has support 993. Of course, I have the same support for the reversed rule, mountain bottle, cage, then water bottle. So it's time to calculate the confidence. I will start again with finding all possible pairs, defining the rules and calculating support, and then I will count distinct order number grouped by model. So I will count the how many times each model appears alone. And then I can find the confidence by dividing the support for the combination with the support for the condition. And then I can order by support and then by confidence. So let's see again. Query becomes a little bit more complex. And I see, of course, support 993, mountain bottle, cage, water bottle. But please note, if mountain bottle, cage is on the left and then water bottle on the right, we have confidence 83%. The opposite, if water bottle, then mountain bottle, cage, the confidence is only 40%. So apparently, the first rule is better. Now let me switch back to slides for a second. Let's define 2 more terms I can calculate. Lift and order. The lift tells you how many times more is likely that a customer buys product B when product A is in the basket compared to likelihood of buying product B alone. So it's probability of A and B divided by probability of A multiplied by probability of B. And here we have another interesting measure for the quality of the rule. Sometimes you have order in line items. In my case, in my example, I have order because we are talking about internet sales. So line item with higher number came to the basket later than line item with the lower number. In a retail store, of course, you cannot rely upon the order because when you come to cashier, the order is completely mixed. If you have an order, you can try to find out sequential association rules that enforce particular order in purchases. And this order can be defined either with date and time or with sequential number. So let me go back and do some more calculations. So remember, so far we have calculated support and confidence. Let's add lift. So first we have all pairs, all possible item sets of two items. Then I define rules and then I count the support for the condition. And then I can calculate confidence, right? But then I can calculate the total number of orders with count distinct order number. Let's execute this subquery only. So I have 13,006 orders. And I can actually do the cross join here, which means that I am basically adding a column to the previous result set. I'm cross joining with a single row because I have aggregate function count distinct. And this is now new column number of orders. And then I can calculate the lift. This is support divided by number of orders and then divided by support for the first model in the item set and support for the second model in the item set divided by the number of orders to get the probability. And this way I can also use ordering by the lift. Let's execute the whole query. It is becoming really, really long. So I have Turing tire tube. We have support 506, which is support percent is less than 4%. Confidence Turing tire tube is nearly 90%, the opposite only 56%. But the lift is 12 times. I have nearly 13 times more probability that Turing tire will appear in the basket when Turing tire tube is there, and also the opposite is true. Turing tire tube will appear in a basket 13 times more if Turing tire is in it than when it is alone. Now, of course, I can do ordering based on many, many different criteria. For example, let's order again by support and then confidence, but I can also see the lift. And this way, step by step, I can analyze my rules and find those that are most important for me. Remember, the highest support is for mountain bottle cage water bottle. Also, lift is pretty high, so this is definitely an important rule. Let's order by confidence. And then let's say lift to check the different order. And let's see what I get now. This is how you really work. You have to check many different ways, ordered in many different ways to find the most important rules. So we have very, very high confidence, a road bottle cage, then water bottle, also high support and quite high lift. Remember, the highest lift nearly 13 times is Turing tire, Turing tire tube. So you can really find these important rules pretty quickly. Now let me finally try to add the sequence. So I will find all possible pairs and I'm again joining on order number or applying this based on order number equality. Model from the left is different from model from the right, and line number from the left is lower than line number from the right. So I'm adding sequence. Basically, that's it. If I have line numbers or date times, it's very simple. I only changed a single condition and then I can calculate everything I wish. So let me execute this big query, adding this sequence. And now, of course, support is lower. All these terms went down because now I really want to have mountain tire tube in this example on the left, sport what 100 on the right, and then I have support 747. If mountain tire tube, then sport 100. So I have also the sequence in this shopping included. I could stop here, but I can still continue with my analysis. Are there some typical products which are always starting a shopping sequence or ending a shopping sequence? Let's find minimum and maximum line number. It's 1 and 8. So I will add to every single order a fictitious model begin and a fictitious model end, begin with line number 0 and end with line number 9. So end will be after all of other products, 0 will be begin before all other products. So let's calculate association rules with sequence, with begin and end products. And let's see what I get. So begin end, of course, is the most popular combination because I added it to every single order. Sport 100 end has a very, very huge support, also pretty huge confidence. Begin Sport 100 has also quite big support because, of course, it's also begin on the every single order where Sport 100 is. However, the confidence is much lower than for combination Sport 100 end. So apparently Sport 100 is one of those products where people finish shopping. And this way I have another possibility of analyzing my association rules. Now I'm switching to predictive modeling. I will talk about two algorithms that can be easily implemented in TransactSQL, or let's say not easily but efficiently. First will be look-alike model, which will be a combination of decision trees and k-nearest neighbor, and then Bayesian inference or naive Bayes. Before I start with look-alike modeling, let me briefly explain how decision trees work. Decision trees assign or classify each case to one of a few discrete broad categories of target or selected attribute variable, and then it explains this classification with few selected input variables. Decision trees is a very popular data mining algorithm because once a tree is built, it is very easy to understand. Once it is built, you can also use it to predict values of the explained variable. The algorithm, the formal definition is recursive partitioning. Data is split into partitions and then split up more. Initially, we have all cases in one big box. Then we can calculate the distribution of the target variable in overall dataset. The algorithm first tries all possible breaks in classes using all possible values of each discrete input attribute. So, for example, we have marital status, single merit, we split data into two subgroups, single merit, and then we check the distribution of the target variable in these two subgroups. Then we might have level of education from 1 to 5, and then we can try again with split over education and check the distribution of target variable in every single subclass. We can even do splits over every single subclass or over combination of subclasses. For example, we can make a split of education 1 and 2 together, 3, 4, 5 together, lower, higher. We can do all possible breaks we can imagine. And then we select the break that gives us the purest classes of the searched or target variable, purest in terms of its value. So, for example, if target variable is true, false, 1, 0, and initially we have distribution around 50-50. If one split gives me distribution 70-30 and 40-60, another split gives me the distribution 80-20 and 30-70, then the second split is better because it gives us better purity of the target variable in subclasses. We can use simple measure of purity as frequency distribution or more complex measures like entropy or even Bayesian scoring of prior posterior probabilities. Remember, I will talk about Bayesian inference very soon. So after this initial split, we continue with the splitting process. So each new subclass we split again and again and test all possible breaks. So we can do this in a loop. You can immediately imagine that looping is not very efficient in transact SQL. Also, there is a problem where to stop. Decision trees has a well-known problem of overfitting. You could finish with subclasses where you would have a single case, and with a single case, the target variable can occupy a single state only, so the purity would be 100%. However, the value would be approximately zero. You don't want to make predictions based on a single case. Here is an example of a decision tree. We have a target variable, faces showing whether people liked or didn't like some product. And we made a split, initial split over age. Initially, we have approximately half people that liked the product, half people that didn't like. After the split over age at the value of 35, the older people, we have 73% of people that liked the product and 27% that didn't like. And with younger than 35, one-third liked, two-thirds didn't like the product. So we make second split over education. In the group of older people, we make a split at education level 2. And if education level is 2 or higher and people are 35 years or older, then we have already 87% of people that like the product. If education is 2 or lower and age 35 or higher, we have 1/3 only that like the product, 2/3 that didn't like. The second group of Younger people, we make a split education level of 5. If it's lower than 5, then only 17% of people like the product, 83 didn't. If it's higher than 5, then 67% of people like the product and 33 didn't. Now I have a full grown tree. Now I can take a new case, check the age and education and see in which class this new case will fall, and then calculate the probabilities of the target variable in this class and use this as a prediction. Of course, again, imagine that passing through data in many, many loops is not really possible with TransactSQL or not really useful. So let me introduce another interesting algorithm, k-nearest neighbors algorithm. This one is usually used on a continuous target variable. It is also called instance-based learning. There is no learning at all. Because there is no learning at all, you don't need to pass through the data, not even a single time, no loops. No action until a new input pattern demands an output value. This is also called lazy learning. For predicting a class of a target variable of a new case, K train cases that most resemble the new instance are searched using the input features. Small k might lead to high variance, large k decreases the variance but raises the bias. You might get what is called local maximums, cases that are accidentally close together. If you have continuous variables, you should scale them, use z-score normalization so they have similar mean and standard deviation. This is shown graphically. I have two input variables. This is my target case. So I'm searching for, in first example, three closest neighbors, second example, the blue line, eight closest neighbors, and then I calculate the average of the target variable of these cases or the distribution of target variable of these cases, and then use this as a value for predicting the target variable in the searched case. So look-alike modeling is a combination of decision trees and KNN. It's finding groups of people who look similar or like your existing cases. Find the group and then calculate the probabilities of the target variable states, or average if you have a continuous target variable, you could also calculate other population moments like standard deviation and so on. Now, this is like having a developed decision trees. Now, I have a new case and I check how it joins to these old cases, joins based on education and age, and find appropriate group and calculate the distribution of the target variable. So we are calculating distribution of target variable in classes of input variables, like in this graph. So I'm calculating distribution of the bike buyer target variable. Initially I have half buyers, half non-buyers, but then we can see that in region Pacific we have nearly 60% of buyers, and then if we check number of cars owned, then with zero cars I have many more buyers than with two, three or four cars. We can also check commute distance. The higher the commute distance, the less bike buyers we have. This is the logic of the algorithm. Now I must find appropriate groups. So let me switch to the demo. I will create numerical index from string ordinal variables. I will create numerical classes from nominals. Okay. And discretize continuous variables with equal height binning. So I will have approximately equal amount, equal number of cases in each class. And I will create character one variables from numerical ordinal variables. So I will have like one character per variable, and then I will combine these characters into a single variable, which I will use for grouping and joining. Let's call this grouping factor. So let's go and start working. So for example, I will create index from 1 to 5, character index for education, partial high school 1, high school 2, up to graduate degree, which will have index 5. We can even handle possible nulls. And then I will check commute distance, another ordinal variable, 10 plus miles is the highest value. And then I will switch to occupation and again create a character one variable. Region, again, we will create three possibilities, Europe, North America, Pacific, and also handle possible nulls. Equal height distribution, equal number of cases in each subgroup, will do discretization of age and yearly income into five subgroups using entile function. And for total children, I will also handle nulls with the isNull function. So if it's null, we'll say it is zero. Number of cars owned, we have values between 0 and 4. I will group 3 and 4 into a single class. So let's check what I did. Let's check what I did with this discretization. So I am preparing a variable which can be used for joining and grouping the data. So for this case, I have education 3, commute distance 3, occupation 1, region 3, age first class, income first class, 0 children, 1 car. And we can check also the source data if this was done correctly. I already checked this, so I will not lose time with rechecking. Now I can create a new combined variable, and this will be grouping factor. And then I can calculate counts per groups. So let's calculate counts per groups and order by counts. Please note that I'm using less variables and less bins to create broader groups. And I have some group where count is 1, and then most of the groups are much more useful. Remember the problem of overfitting. If you have a single case in a group, then of course you will get 100% sure predictions, but of course useless. So how do you prevent overfitting? Well, the simplest way of preventing overfitting is to stop growing the tree when you have not enough cases in the new subgroups. Of course, if you do this in iterations, you check this dynamically. Since I don't have iterations, I just check the counts and I see that with initial grouping over 6 variables, then I got many groups with less than 10 cases. Now when I combined 4 variables only and even created less classes for some variables, for example commute distance, I grouped in 3 classes only, I got groups with more cases. Of course I can imagine that the accuracy of predictions will be slightly worse, but at least it will be statistically significant. Okay, let me create test and training set. Now, I will not actually do any training. I'm just splitting the data into training and test set using the cryptgenrandom function to create approximately a random split. So I will create 30% of rows will put into test set, 5,546 rows, and I will add other rows to the training set, so-called training set, because there will be no training. And I will also add a cluster at index cluster at primary key on the training set using the grouping factor and bike buyer columns. Now let's check the distribution of bike buyers in groups using the grouping factor, and I have I can calculate probability what is as average of 1.0 multiplied by the flag 0 or 1. So 0.63 means I have 63% of bike buyers in the group 1, 1, 1, 1, whatever does it mean. Now I could check the original data to see what this groups means. This group means. Now I'm searching for lookalike cases from testing to training set and calculate the prediction for the target variable. So I'm using test set and I'm using outer apply. Remember, there might be even group with zero cases. And then I'm calculating average of bike buyer for the appropriate group, where grouping factor of the test case equals to the grouping factor of the training cases. So I'm joining or applying each test case on multiply training cases and then averaging the bike buyer. And then with IIF, I define if probability predicted is greater than 0.5, the outcome is 1, otherwise 0. And here we have customer key, grouping factor, bike buyer, and this is probability and bike buyer predicted. So I see in first two cases, predicted value is correct. In third, also negative. However, in fourth and fifth cases, the predicted values are incorrect. I can also check the counts, number of cases on which this prediction is based. And I can also check the input variables. So this was commute distance 5 to 10 miles, region Pacific, income 70,000 with a single car. Now I can calculate the accuracy of predictions. I can calculate the accuracy as number of correct predictions, true positives, true negatives, divided by the total number of cases predicted. So I will do the prediction in a common table expression, and then I will group by bike buyer actual values and predicted and create what is called confusion or classification matrix. So here we have 0, 0 means true negatives, 1, 1 means true positives. The value is predicted is positive, the actual is also positive. 0, 1 is incorrect, false positive. I predicted this person would buy a bike, but actually didn't. Of course, this set is created from known data, so it is easy to check the accuracy. So we have 0, 0, 1903 cases. Let's also calculate the accuracy, and then we have 1, 1. 1607 cases. So these are true predictions, true negatives, true positives, divided by, of course, the total number of cases. I simply add up all counts in every single subgroup, and then I can calculate the accuracy. So in this case, accuracy was 0.63%. Let me copy also this number. It doesn't look too impressive. However, remember, I did only a single pass, not even a single pass through data. I've just read the target variable using four input variables only. With different variables, more input variables, more classes of input variables, I could get better accuracy. I tested on this data and it's really not that bad, because even with very sophisticated algorithms with many, many loops in R and Python, I managed to get accuracy like 70% only. But Remember, there was no training at all, so this is extremely scalable. It's just one lookup into the training cases. So we came to the last algorithm for this session. I will talk about Bayesian inference, also called naive Bayes algorithm. The naive Bayes is a predictive algorithm, but it's pretty fast. It quickly builds mining models that you can use for data overview, classification, and prediction. It calculates probabilities for each possible state of the input attribute given each state of the predictable attribute. The probabilities can be later used to predict an outcome of the predicted attribute based on the known input attributes of a new case. Input attributes are treated as mutually independent, that's why it's sometimes called naive Bayes. Please note this, we are calculating the probabilities of states of input attributes in the states or classes of the predictable attribute. This is the opposite way like we did with lookalike modeling, where we calculated probabilities of the predictable attribute in the states of input attributes. How does it work? And how do we get, based on this calculation, predictions? Imagine that I am buying a second-hand car. From the magazines, I realize that from the second-hand cars, 70% of them are okay and 30% are faulty. So initially, I have 70% probabilities to buy a good car. But I have a friend who is a mechanic, so my friend goes with me on a quick drive. And based on the evaluation of my friend, so these are the declared probabilities. If a car was faulty, in 90% of cases, my friend will declare it as actual faulty. And in 10%, my friend will declare this car as okay. This will be the wrong declaration. From those that are good, 70% that are good, 80% of those will be declared as good, and 20% improperly as faulty. So altogether, my friend will judge 41% cars as faulty, 27 of those that were really faulty, and 14 out of those that were actually okay. And 59% will be judged as okay, 3% improperly, inaccurately of those that were actually faulty, and 56 out of those that were actually okay. Now I can calculate reverse probabilities. So I have 59 declared as okay and 41 as faulty. Out of those 41 that were declared as faulty, 67% were really faulty. If I go back to this tree, so if I go back to this original slide, to the previous slide, out of 41% declared as faulty, 27 or nearly two-thirds were really faulty. This is how we calculate this 67%. Out of those that were declared as good, 95% were actually really good. So after the classification, the posterior probabilities are much more accurate than the prior probabilities. So if I decide to buy a car that was declared as good by my friend, I will have 95% probabilities that this will actually be a good car, compared this to initial 70%. Remember, what we are doing is the opposite process. We are calculating distribution of input variables in classes of the target variable. In my demo, I will try to predict bike buyer, so I'm calculating distribution of region, number cars owned, and commute distance in classes bike buyer true, false, 0, 1, or 1, 0. And I can see that in the classes of one, for example, I have more customers with less cars, with zero and one cars. With two cars, I have mostly non-buyers. Region, we can maybe see the difference, more buyers in Pacific region and less in North America region. Commute distance, the lower the distance, the higher the bar is for buyers. Now, how do I calculate posterior probabilities out of this data? Imagine I have a table like this. I have bike buyer classes 0 and 1, and then I split the data in over in class 0, over region, and over number of cars owned. So in bike buyer 0, region Pacific, I have 0.15% of population. And with number of cars owned 1, I have nearly 24% population. Bike buyer 1, region Pacific, I have 23% of population. Bike buyer, a number of cars owned 1, bike buyer 1, I have nearly 30% of people here. So now I can calculate these posterior probabilities. Remember, let's go back to this table. So I have these values. A, bike buyer 0, number cars owned 1. B, bike buyer 0, region Pacific. C, bike buyer 1, number of cars owned 1. D, bike buyer 1, number of region Pacific. Now I can calculate probability for the state 0 as A multiplied by B divided by A multiplied by B plus C multiplied by D. And probability for the state 1, C multiplied by D divided by A multiplied by B plus C multiplied by D. I actually normalize these likelihoods to probabilities. So for 0, A multiplied by B and divided with A multiplied by B plus C multiplied by D. This is this normalization to get probabilities between 0 and 1. Now I have a problem. I have these terms A in 1 row, B in second row, C in third row, D in fourth row. So I need aggregation over rows. But we don't have aggregate product function, we have aggregate sum. Can we somehow transform product to sum? Yes, we can. We know formulas of the logarithmic equations. Logarithm of A multiplied by B equals logarithm A plus logarithm B. So if I calculate logarithm of the values, I can summarize them and then I can I get logarithm of the product. And then I use exponential function to calculate the actual aggregate product. So let's start with this naive Bayes. Now I have lookalike model already created, so I have already training and test tables. And let's check if they are still here and what is the data in them. So I have a couple of input attributes, including grouping factor and bike buyer and the membership. I denoted membership trial or test. So let's calculate a single feature distribution in a class of a target variable. So I'm calculating counts of region and percentages of region in the class of bike buyer equals 1. So where bike buyer equals 1, I have 45-46% of people from North America, 24 from Pacific and 30 from Europe. Now let's do the full calculation like I had here in my slide for multiple attributes. How do I get this full calculation in a single query? Well, I can get it with grouping sets. So I will group by group in six, grouping sets, three variables, region, number of cars owned, and commute distance. And then I will calculate for bike buyer equals one, and then for bike buyer equals zero. And I will get a single result set with union all. I will calculate the percentage by adding the count star from each subgroup with a cross join. Of course, again, I can do the cross join since this is only a single row. So I'm joining all input rows to a single rows. So let's see what did I get. So I have this table. Bike buyer 0, and then of course region null and commute distance null mean this is grouping by number of cars owned, and then grouping by region for bike buyer 0, and initially it was grouped by commute distance for bike buyer 0, and then all calculations repeated for bike buyer equals 1. Here is the data from the DBOTM test from the test dataset. Remember, for lookalike model, I actually didn't do any training. Here, I will do a training with a single query. So I will create a model. I will store the data from training in the model called TMNB, like target male neighbors. Now I will calculate the counts, and from TM train, of course, counts and percentage by cross joining to select count star from DBOTM train where bike buyer equals 1, and then group by grouping sets region, number of cars owned, commute distance, and then do union all with the same query for bike buyer equal 0. So let's do this, and in a single query, I am creating my model. Not so extremely efficient as lookalike model, where I didn't do any training at all, still quite efficient. Now, I can check all of the data, 26 rows, or I can check data for specific subclass, region 1, number of cars, region Pacific, number of cars 1, or commute distance 2 to 5 miles. And I have bike buyer equals 0, bike buyer equals 1. Now let's calculate probabilities for this specific case. Here are these results. Let's calculate from these likelihoods, probabilities for two variables only. Number of cars equals 1 and region Pacific. So we have this one, likelihood for 0. Let me copy it in my query that will calculate the probabilities for the state 0 and then also the probabilities for the state 1. And we have region equals Pacific. So let's copy also this number in the formula. And then also likelihoods for the state 1, number of cars owned. This. and region equals Pacific. For the bike buyer equals 1. So based on these two variables, let me calculate the probabilities for the state 0 and for the state 1. Based on these two variables, I have nearly 2/3 of probabilities for the state 1. Now, how do I get aggregate product? Remember this formula from logarithms. So I have simple virtual table with four values, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can use the sum function to summarize those values and I get sum of 10. And I can summarize the logarithm of values and then use exp function to get the aggregate product, which is 24. 1 multiplied by 2 is 2, multiplied by 3 is 6, multiplied by 4 is 24. So let's do some prediction with variables. So I will define two possible percentages, positive, negative. For bike buyer equals 1, region Pacific, number cars owned 1, commute distance 2 to 5 miles. And I'm checking the data from the Naive Bayes model. And then I change these likelihoods to probabilities. And I have negative likelihood, positive likelihood, positive probability, approximately 2 times, even nearly 3 times higher than likelihood, and negative probability. Now let me do the prediction query. So I have this prediction query. I'm summarizing data for bike buyer equals 0. I'm calculating aggregate product for bike buyer equals 1. And then I will calculate the actual probability for bike buyer. So this will be prediction in this case, where we have region Pacific, number of cars 1, commute distance 2 to 5 miles. I predict a person will be bike buyer with nearly 72% probability. So let me create prediction function that will accept region, number of cars owned, and commute distance as variables. And then do this same calculation for bike buyer equals 0 and 1, looking into the model where I have this probabilities or distribution of input variables in the classes of target variables stored. Now I can use cross apply to do the full prediction on the test set. And for customer 11005, region Pacific, number of cars 1, commute distance predicted is 1. The actual probability 0.57. And this one, North America, 3 cars, 0 to 1 miles, predicted is 0. Again, I can see first two are predicted correctly, and then third is predicted correctly, but then I have fourth and fifth incorrectly predicted as non-buyers. Let's calculate the accuracy. So let's do again this confusion matrix. So full prediction on full test set, and then do the confusion matrix. And I have the following numbers. True negatives 1785. And then I have true positives 1541. And then I have false positives 997. And then I have false negatives 1223. So let me calculate the accuracy. and the accuracy is a little bit less than 60%. Let's copy also this number. Remember, look-alike model, I got slightly better accuracy. I got accuracy like 63%. So look-alike model was slightly better than Bayesian inference, but remember in Bayesian inference I actually used 3 variables, only in look-alike model I used 4 variables. Altogether, we are at the end of this presentation, so let me clean up my AdventureWorks DW 2017 database and thank you again for joining me in this presentation, and thank you for joining to this in this to be together in this great conference. Hope we all meet next week. Enjoy other presentations, the rest of the conference, and I will be still around 10-15 minutes for questions.